Yep. I'm on air. Okay, do me a favor and get out the worksheets, please.
For what?
Yeah, the
all of them? Integration.
Integration, yeah. Oh, not all of them.
Miss K?
Yes.
So then October, November 2006, number 8, it doesn't give you like a visual, and then it's y equals 6 over 5 minus 2x.
How about I do that one?
Yeah, so wouldn't that be an asymptote?
Not necessarily, because it's just a portion of the graph. It depends on where they want you to do it from.
So they would only care about like the...
From 0 to 1.
So they would give you that?
They give you that. Mm-hmm. But so, yes, you're right. It has an asymptote. But the asymptote doesn't fall in that range. The asymptote, let's look.
And that one's kind of hard since they don't give you a visual. You have to kind of
you
make it yourself.
Right, you just have to know the steps. So yeah. You don't really have to draw it, which is kind of a cool thing. It says the region between the curve and the x-axis and the lines x equals 0 and x equals 1 are rotated about 360 about the x-axis. Show that the volume... given me the volume, is 12 pi over 5.
Okay.
So, he is 100% right that this does have an asymptote. Where would the asymptotes be? Yeah, you set this equal to 0. You set the bottom. And so you add 2x divide. So if I'm looking at it, I got 5 minus 2x equals 0. 5 equals 2x. 5 halves equals x. So the asymptote occurs at 2.5. So you are 100% right. If we have an asymptote in the problem, we got to be careful because is that part of where we're rotating? But this is telling me to rotate, and it wants me to rotate from the curve to the x-axis from 0 to 1. So what are my walls on this thing? 0 and 1. Where does the asymptote occur? 2.5. Does that make sense? So I'm looking at curve, x-axis, 0, 1. 2.5 is out there. It doesn't even affect what this rotation will look like. Did that make sense, what I just said? I believe. No, so I want to make sure you get that. See, there's a no-no spot here, and that no-no spot is the asymptote, where it causes a zero in the denominator, right? Mm-hmm. So if I set that equal to 0, I discover that it happens at 5 halves, 2.5. So I know that, and I don't even care what this thing looks like, but I know from 0 to 1, curve, 4, right? So it's only going to go from 0 to 1, whatever my curve looks like, to 0
so
to
the like
x.
All of that you just said was like irrelevant to this.
Right, so 2.5 is out here. His question was, there's an asymptote in the problem. Right. How is that going to affect the rotation? Well, it does not in this case because I only care from here to here.
If it was?
They wouldn't. Oh. They wouldn't. They would never, right? So we're going to go around, and we don't care about 2.5. Whatever happens over there, it's not part of my visual picture. Yes?
How do you know what the asymptote looks like?
Well, how do I know where it occurs is at 2.5, because that's what causes that denominator to be 0.
Which is a no-no.
An asymptote goes like this. Right. So something happens on the left of the asymptote, something happens on the right of the asymptote. It really don't matter what it really looks like. Yes.
Isn't it an asymptote like where it goes like this and then this
that
or,
could be one of the, uh-huh.
or this and then
right,
like
exactly.
where they never touch or cross?
Correct. So this thing could come up like so and that could come down like so. You know, so that's the kind of thing that's happening here. To be honest with you, they're not looking for you to create the visual of it. They just want you to find the volume of it.
Uh-huh.
So we know how to find the volume through the series of steps that we've learned. Okay? So things that I have to ask myself, am I having a party or not?
No.
No party.
No party.
No party. I know no party. Why? Because I'm rotating about the x-axis, right? So the second question I ask myself is, am I attached to the place at which I'm rotating? Am I attached to the place at which I'm rotating?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So therefore, there's no hole.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
So we use the disk method.
Right. So we're going to go pi from A to B. What's A and B?
1 to 0.
Okay. 0 to 1, right? What's my radius?
6.
It's this thing. Is the ceiling. Yes.
Why are you using that?
The formula is pi r squared.
For a cylinder?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, rotation of the...
All right.
Basically, you're finding... Remember when I gave you the little... if I cut it, you see a circle. If I cut it, you see a circle. Remember that? That whole game.
The Hershey's?
The Hershey's.
Wait, did we get a packet on Thursday, by the way?
We had a packet from 2 weeks ago. We're using the same packet.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this thing is rotating, 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 touching the place at which it rotates, no hole. So my ceiling minus floor is this minus this. So it's the actual equation minus zero.
Which doesn't matter.
So it doesn't really matter, right? So that... Okay. And it's going to be squared. Why squared? Because that's part of the formula. The x-axis? Mm-hmm. The x-axis. Yeah.
So what does that 2.5 do? Like, what is that? That doesn't really matter.
It doesn't even matter. It's not even part of the picture. This is the only thing that's rotating.
So when we see, like, an asymptote like that, it's not meant to really trick you.
No, not at all. Mm-mm. Yeah, they won't do that for you. They won't make an asymptote in the middle of your picture. Okay? All right, so are we good so far? So this just now becomes algebra slash one-step calculus slash algebra. Remember how that works, right? So if I'm looking at this thing, I have a little bit of algebra to do first. Well, quite a bit of algebra to do first, okay? So one of the things I recognize is that that this thing is going to need to flip to the top. Is everybody okay with that?
Yes.
Because it's to the negative one.
It's to the 1 down below, so it would be to the negative 1 up top. So I'd have pi from 0 to 1, 6, 5 minus 2x to the negative 1, all that stuff squared.
You're going to have to use the substitution.
What were you doing? Bring the negative 1 to the 2, negative 2.
We're going to do that.
But you can't expand that thing out if it's
not
to a negative.
Right, correct. No, it would not. Here's my next question. What's a mistake somebody's going
to
make?
Forget to square the
6. That's really, really important. So that 6 has to be manipulated by that square as well. So keep working it slowly. I would have 36, because 6 squared. And then I would have 5 minus 2x to the
negative 2.
Yes.
Could you bring the 36 out?
I would 100% do that. I would say,
is
oh my gosh,
where the pi?
Put it with a pi.
36 times pi?
Yep. So the next thing I would make it look like is 36 times pi from 0 to 1 of 5 minus 2x to the negative 2. Yes?
Can you only bring something out front if it's not being multiplied by x?
Yes. Give me a second. What if it looked like this? Give me a sidebar. What if it was like 2 minus 4x? Can I bring the 2 out to the front?
Because it's one term.
Because it's an individual term. Right. Okay? If it's attached to x like that, can I pull the 4 out?
Yes.
Oh.
You see the difference?
Yeah.
Okay. So if it's individual terms, you integrate. Because this is a whole thing with x, that 6 up front is 36 up front comes out. Yes.
You probably wouldn't, but in theory, if it was the 2 minus 4x, could you factor out 2 and then bring it to the front?
I wouldn't.
I wouldn't, but
because then you make it a unit. I would want them individually, so I would want to make them a unit. Yes, but don't. Yes.
But let's say if this was 36 plus 5 minus 2x to the negative 2, then it would be 36x.
Correct. Yeah. Correct.
Right.
You see the difference? That's a really good lesson. Now, what's that thing?
Do you substitute
this? Yeah. Now you're going to do it the way I taught you because that's the way you prefer. Some people prefer the kind of the easier method. You make that call, okay? So whatever one's easiest for you. So I would have 36 pi, right?
Yes.
And a lot of people like that new method where they just take the unit and do it an integral to it. So it would be 5 minus 2x to the negative 1
so
over
negative
1.
So you don't have to rewrite the one big. The 1 to 0 because you just integrated.
Because you're now integrating, okay. And then what am I going to multiply by down here?
The derivative of the inside.
Right, which is?
Negative 2.
Right. Yes.
When you do a derivative, are you dividing by negative 2 or multiplying?
Remember, you pull out a negative 1 half, right? You pull out a negative. You need to multiply by negative 2, pull out a negative 1 half.
Because it undoes that.
So it would be 36 pi over negative 2.
Yeah. Yes.
First plus
Do I need a plus C? Tell me why I wouldn't.
Do you have an
integral?
It's an integral, but why specifically would I not need a plus C? Good question, huh?
You have an A and a B.
I have an A and a B, so why I don't need a C. Does that make sense? All right, so now I'm going to clean her up a little bit, and I think you guys have gotten kind of comfortable with this. 36, okay, wait, ooh, 0 to 1, right? I think you guys have gotten kind of comfortable with this, that 36 pi divided by 2, right? Make life easier for ourselves. That's just a whole number. All this right here is just some number, right? So what's 36 pi divided by 2? 18 pi?
18 pi.
Okay. So, well, I have two negatives make a positive, so I think positive.
They all cancel out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you integrate correctly? When you added one whole to your U and you put it over itself, you should put over negative 1, right?
Well, I didn't do it like that.
No, no, I know. I'm talking about your, look at your paper. Mm-hmm. When you added one whole to it, you got negative 2, added one whole, you got negative 1 over negative 1. And then, but when you pulled out a negative 1/2, right? Okay. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. So now I have 18 pi, and it's going to be 5. Do you guys agree it's 1 over?
Yeah.
1 over 5 minus 2x to the first. Mm-hmm. And that's from 0 to 1. Are we okay? So 18 pi is just kind of going for the ride, going to go for the ride, right?
Yep.
Plug in the 1, what do you get? 18 pi is going for the ride. If I plug in 1, I get 1 over 5 minus 2. So 1 over 3?
1 over 3.
Yeah.
You
got to
do the 0.
Try the 0.
0 and it, yeah, it makes a difference.
It does, it makes a difference. Be careful, don't be complacent. So 1 over 5. 1/3 minus 1/5. So 5/15 minus 3/15, that's how I see it, right? So 18 pi, and then I got a common denominator. I got 18 pi times 2/15, I think you would agree.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. 18 pi times 2/15, if I multiply it out, I get 36/15 pi.
Sure.
So 36/15 pi. Not quite what I need.
You need to reduce it.
Reduce it by
3.
Good. So 12 pi over 5. Smiley face.
Yes.
What do you think?
Good.
You get it, right? It's not a bad subject. Honestly, it makes me smile because this is really high-level calculus that you're working on at this level.
Pretty much what we're doing is just doing the same thing, just putting pi and square into it.
Absolutely. 100, absolutely. If you are comfortable with areas, the volumes come naturally. Things people forget. They forget pi. They forget to square. They forget to square everything. Okay, so those are like mistakes that can be made. Yes?
When you have an asymptote, like, how should you draw it on your graph? Like, you just, like a little thing? Like a little squiggly?
It's dotted lines.
Why do you square everything?
Because the formula is pi r squared.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
So it's the same thing as finding integrals just with a pi in
there. Same thing as finding area. The only difference is you have a pi in front because you're rotating and you're making it circular. Mm-hmm. And then square it. Yes.
So on the packet issues or II questions, so are we going to have to factor the pi and then this is II?
Quite possibly.
The regularization
area. Yeah. A lot of them are finding the two places at which they meet, or
the normal line, the tangent line.
Some old, like, review stuff. So, it doesn't hurt to go back over it. Yes.
Let's see. May, June 2010/12, that's a good, washer method.
Okay,
like,
let's
it's,
do it.
Where it's, like, not together.
Not touching.
There's a
it's
hole.
The Walter method.
The washer method is where there's a hole. There's a hole. Can I erase this one? Is everybody good?
I'll just watch the videos.
May, June 2010/12, number 11. We did that in class?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Ooh, I don't
want to.
Wait, number
11.
We do
11.
We do. No, we did. We did 2.
Yes.
Did we already do it?
No, we did 2. May, June
12.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Or not yet, we October, November 2006.
Oh, it's actually, it's October, November 2010 slash 12. For some reason, I wrote May, June.
Did you?
Yeah. Can I take it from you real quick?
It's this one.
Okay.
I think it's to the 1/4.
Terrible, sorry. Can't read that small stuff. You gotta
feel sorry for me a little bit.
just an ounce. Okay, so the diagram shows part of a curve, y equals 3x plus 1 to the 1/4. The curve cuts the y-axis at A, and the line x equals 5 at B. We'll do part I as well. Show that the equation of the line AB is y equals negative 1/10 x plus 1. So yes.
I did that part. What I did was I found the coordinates for A and B.
Okay.
And then I found the slope, y2 minus y1, over, and then I got the equation from that.
Perfect. So what he said was, for me to be able to find this unknown line, straight line, right? He said, well, if I know this ordered pair, and I know this ordered pair, then I could use the y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1 to find the slope, and then use my Thayer formula. Yeah. So let's go through that process. A is here, right?
X is 0.
That's B. So you just got done telling me that for A, x is 0. Okay, how do you know that? What is it called?
Because it's on the y-axis.
Right, so y-intercept, right? And then B,
x is 5.
Oh,
good. Just plug those in.
And you just plug them in to the curve. Why? Because that's the place at which they cross,
yep.
Right? Because the curve and the line share that point with 0 for x, and they share that point with 5 for x. Is everybody okay with that? So if I plug in 0 here, I get 1 over...
1 over 1, which is 1, yeah.
Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah.
So it's 0, it's 0, 1. Are we okay? And then for 5, so I have 1 over 16 to the 1/4, and what's 16 to the 1/4?
2.
So 1 over 2. Does it make sense that it should be smaller than 1?
Yes.
Because the line goes down. Right? I mean, if we got 10 as our answer there, we'd be like thinking about what we might have done wrong. Hopefully we recognize that. Okay, so we're at a point now. We know our two ordered pairs. So can we actually find the slope of AB? Sure. Good old-fashioned. And how many points is this good old-fashioned?
4.
Oh, that's not bad. It's not bad at all.
So today that's like 3?
Yeah, probably 3 in today's world. So we're going to do y minus y over... Right? You see, I'm going to be consistent. I put 1 first. So 0 minus 5. Everybody okay?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we're good? Ian, you're good? Okay, 1 minus 1/2 is 1/2. And 0 minus 5 is negative 5. Really, negative 5 over 1.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Because I want a fraction divided by a fraction because it's easier to work with. I'm going to flip that guy up and multiply by the reciprocal. So I have 1/2. Times negative 1/5, which is negative 1/10. So the slope is negative 1/10. Are we okay?
Yes.
Okay, so we found
the slope. Now can we find the equation? Well, we're going to use my favorite form in the world. And which ordered pair would I use?
The A is easier.
A is easier, right? So y minus 1 equals negative 1 tenth times x minus 0.
Yeah.
Is everybody okay? Mm-hmm. So y is equal to negative 1 tenth x plus 1. Because I multiplied 0 through and add 1. And that's what I was looking for?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
So if you plugged in the other order pair,
you would get the same thing. Yeah. Kind of cool how that works, if you ask me. Okay, so now, are we in a good spot where we found AB? What are other ways that potentially we could find lines in these types of problems? What are other ways that we have used to find lines? Yes.
Well, if you have the equation of two lines and you know they intersect, you can set them equal to each other.
Okay, that's one. Set them equal to each other, find the ordered pairs. That's a good question. That's a good thing that we could do. What's another thing that potentially could come up with these types of questions? I'm just thinking like a teacher, like what kind of questions might come up on an ACE exam. Anything else? I think this is an oddity that they actually gave you 2 points that you actually use y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1, because we haven't used that in a long, long time.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
What do we normally use to find the equation of a line?
Isn't it usually solve the normal way?
What's that?
Isn't the, like, we just solve the normal way, x it?
Like a normal way, but what has become our normal way? I guess my question is really not an easy question. What is it?
Derivatives.
Yeah, derivatives, right? Beautiful. Thank you. So
yeah.
Derivatives normally is the way they go. Normally they'll give you they'll say that one of them is a tangent to the other one, and they want you to take a derivative and find the actual slope. And then, so think about that. They could do this type of problem in multiple different ways, one of which could be derivatives to find the equation of a line. Yes.
They could do normal line.
Yeah, they could find a normal line as well.
Yeah.
So you have to kind of think outside the box. Remember, when I teach you the concepts, I can't tell you these are exactly the ways they're going to ask you the questions. We just have to be able to use all our tools to kind of make the answers come about. So, all right, so now we're at a place where we have this line. We know it's y equals negative 1 tenth x plus 1,
uh-huh.
Right? And then we know we have this curve, which is 1 over 3x plus 1 to the 1 4th. I'm going to assume it's going to rotate about the x-axis.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So are we having a party or not?
No party.
No party. But there is a hole, right?
What
so
does
there's,
that mean?
Okay, so if I'm rotating horizontally, it's kind of dull. If I'm rotating vertically, I'm having a party,
okay.
Right?
Okay.
You'll see my video. I had corny jokes involved as well.
Okay.
Yeah, so I know you're surprised about that. So what we're going to do now is we're going to find a place at which it rotates. So this guy comes over here, comes down through, and comes back up, making some random three-dimensional shape. The flower.
Sausage.
So, sausage sounds good. Yes.
So when we do
the rotation?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We'll do... Are you going to pi for this one too?
I hate what?
Do you use pi for this?
Absolutely.
Why are you going to pi for every single one?
Because it's a rotation, and when you cut it, you literally see circles.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's going to be, let's talk a little bit about how that works, because I think last time I did this one, somebody said it was truly beneficial to draw what the outer and inner radius, I think we talked about that in this class. So my outer radius starts here at the very top of the ceiling,
uh-huh.
And it works all the way down to the place at which I rotate, which is 0 in this case.
Okay.
Okay. Then my inner radius starts at the bottom of the picture, and it works its way all the way down to the place at which I rotate. Okay?
Yes.
So what we are basically going to have to do is we're going to have to find the outer radius squared minus the inner radius squared. So it's going to be pi from what to what?
Zero to five.
Zero, five. Y0 and 5. 0 is my leftmost x. 5 is my rightmost x. Okay, those are my walls. So what's my ceiling? Okay, I'm looking at purple. What's my ceiling to floor in the purple one?
Negative 1 over 10x
plus 1. And then minus 0, so that doesn't matter, right?
Yes.
And then what do I have to do that?
Square it.
Square it, that's right. So far, so good. It's going to be ugly.
Do you subtract?
Then I'm minus inner radius. What's my inner radius?
It's 1
over
3x.
Can you just bring that up?
To 1/4.
Are you going to bring it up right now? Okay, so what am I going to say?
3x
plus 1. Plus 1 to the negative 1, 4.
And then...
Oh, that's awful. Fourth squared. Wowie. Yeah, they made this fun. Okay. Are we okay so far? Does everybody understand why, which one's the outer radius and why the one that's the inner radius is what it is? Questions about that? Does anybody have any problems why we're squaring each individual piece? Does anybody need to know why subtracting? The actual formula, just FYI, is from A to B of the outer radius squared minus inner radius squared, okay? In this case, my outer radius is purple, my inner radius was red. Are we good?
Yep.
So, the thing here, it's telling me to square. What do I need to do to first?
Foil it out.
Because remember I told you, do as much algebra first, then come back to the calculus. So really I'm taking negative 1 over 10x plus 1 times negative 1 over 10x plus 1. Ooh, that's going to be pretty.
Gosh.
Yeah. So what does it do? Negative 1 over 10x times negative 1 over 10x is 1 over 100
x squared.
Yucky.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You can't use substitution on that?
No. Well, I would.
Because can you do this over 3?
If you could foil it, you shouldn't. I mean, we could. Yeah. We could try it.
Hey, can I push it?
Yeah.
Are you going to give us a question?
I don't know. I haven't looked at it. I haven't made a test yet. Okay. And then minus, what's that going to be?
Negative one tenth minus one tenth.
So negative 2/10.
Negative two tenths.
X plus one. Again, just algebra until I can actually combine like terms and do calculus. Okay. And then what happens over here? Do I have one more thing I can do to clean this up?
3x plus 1
to the negative 1 half. Okay,
yeah.
So to the negative 1 half. All right, cool. So I'm going to integrate, use substitution. Do you guys see that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, do you guys see why? Integrate, use substitution. And that's okay, just handle them as their own little place. The the 1 over 100 goes for the ride, so it's 1 over 100, and then what's this?
X cubed over 3.
Yep, so far so good. Are we okay?
Yep.
Next
why
one.
Is it X cubed over
3? I add one whole, yeah.
Okay. Over that exponential power.
So I'm going to make this 1/5, negative 1/5.
Okay.
And then what's this?
X squared over 2.
Good. We'll clean that up in a second.
Plus X,
good. Yeah, you do it the old-fashioned way, use substitution, or the new way, however you choose. We got 3x plus 1. If I add one whole, I get
one half. Over 1 half.
Over 1 half times
3.
Let's give me a second.
Is it a 9 point?
Yeah, but it's 9 points.
That bottom part is 9 points?
Yeah.
Yep. It's a big one.
Love it.
Which today is 8 points.
That's very unusual. That's very unusual for it to be that. Well, it's pretty extensive. Okay, so while we're waiting for Clea to finish up her... She's there. She loves that use substitution. What I want to do is just still clean up algebraically now. I see... I'm going to bring it over here. So the whole thing is worth, like, what, 13? Or?
Yeah.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah, 13.
Wow, that's a good one. Okay, so... Pi is going to go for the ride, right?
Yes.
I have 1 over 300. You with me?
Yes.
X to the third. And then minus x squared over 10?
Yes.
I could put x cubed over 300 if I felt comfortable. Yeah?
Yeah.
I like that better, too. Let's do it. X cubed over 300.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
300.
Wait, those are big numbers.
Yeah.
Oh.
Don't do that. Okay, and then cleaning that up, you guys told me 3/2 on the bottom, therefore 2/3 up here.
Yeah.
Right? And then 3x plus 1 to the 1/2. From 0 to 5. Really, they're going to give us a 5 there? That's huge. You see me getting a little nervous.
Oh, my God. Oh, well, you're about to get something big.
I get nervous. Okay, so I'm going to plug in 5. So I've got pi, goes for the ride.
Yes.
I've got 125 over 300, because 5 cubed, right? Minus
25 over 10.
25 over 10.
Plus 5.
Plus 5. Oh, wait, okay, I'm good. Plug in my 5. I get 15 plus 1 is 16 to the 1/2. 4.
Square root of 4.
So.
Yep. Or square root of 16, which is 4.
Yes, 4. So 8/3.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Wait.
Okay, I'll do it again. So I plugged in 5 here. I got 15 plus 1 is 16. Square root of 16 is 4. 4 times 2/3 is 8/3. So that was plugging in 5. Minus parenthesis.
The 0 doesn't do it.
Wait, the square root of 16 is 4.
Wait, did you close the other parenthesis?
No, I'm going to do it at the end.
So it's plus, it's 1 to 1/2.
Because this right here, did I answer your question?
No.
Sorry.
Can you do the 15 plus 1 equals 16, what is that?
Yeah, this is 16, square root of 16 is 4.
4.
4 times 2/3.
Oh, 2/3.
Yeah. Now,
would it be...
play this game with me for a minute. Oh. If I plug in 0, right, I've got 0 here, 0 here.
Zero
here. So the only place that zero matters is here. So it doesn't really need to, you know, so minus 2/3, and then if I plug 0 in here, I get 1 to the 1/2, right? Because 0 plus 1 is 1 to the 1/2, so times 1.
Right.
Close parenthesis.
So minus
2/3
is really
rather plus 2/3.
Oh my God.
It's a lot of prep.
I'm assuming you guys are going to use your calculators for this.
Yeah.
You're not going to do like I do. Actually, look at this. Isn't that negative 8/3 plus 2/3 would be negative 6/3, which is negative 2?
Okay.
Yeah, it's
kind of
cool. What'd you get for the
11 or 12 to be 11 pi over 12.
Oh, so the whole thing is 11 pi over 12?
Wait a
minute. Oh,
okay.
Okay.
1 point?
Yeah. I didn't. So, yeah, we're going to check it. We know pi is in the answer. Got that.
Thank goodness.
That's a good problem.
No.
This, okay. So he said, what happened with the negative 8/3 minus, so negative 8/3 plus 2/3, so then.
Negative 6/3.
So.
Which is negative 2. So it's minus 2. Which is so pretty. Compared to, yeah.
So then I got 0.916 pi.
Yeah, which is 11.
Yeah. So 0.916 pi or 11 pi over 12.
But they'll accept the 0.916.
Mm-hmm. You have to round it
to the near. It's like 3 significant figures.
So it would be 0.917 because it's 6 repeatedly.
It's what?
It's 6 repeating, so it would be.
Significant figures you don't round, though, do you?
Should you?
I don't think so.